Queensland has joined its southern counterparts on alert as the Delta strain runs rampant in New South Wales and Victoria. Case numbers are on the rise across the country. A huge spike in infections putting our healthcare system on alert this morning. This is the state of play. A four-year-old girl in Queensland has tested positive to COVID. She's a close contact to the Logan truck driver who had previously tested positive. This has all prompted the question this morning, is another lockdown on the horizon? New South Wales is boosting staff numbers on the front line, with the Premier warning the peak of the outbreak is 2 weeks away. 1,431 people tested positive yesterday. 12 people sadly died. Victorians are being warned if you're not vaccinated, you could be locked out of pubs, restaurants and sporting events. This as the state records 208 new cases. First to Canberra, where the PM has announced a plane carrying Pfizer from the UK will touch down in Australia this weekend, bringing the first of 4 million doses promised under a vaccine swap deal. Nine Federal Politics reporter Fiona Whelan joins us from Parliament House with more on this. Fee, what will this mean for Australia's vaccine program?
Well, Charles, this deal will double the number of Pfizer doses we have in September. So those 4 million doses will be brought here on 10 flights this month. The first is due to arrive in Australia tomorrow. The UK government is handing over those vaccines, of course, on the condition that we give 4 million back in December. And this is on top of a swap deal the federal government has done with Singapore for 500,000 doses. The PM says these arrangements will break the back of supply issues and hopefully see Australia reopen sooner, because, of course, once we reach vaccination rates of 70 and 80%, National Cabinet has agreed to start easing restrictions. Scott Morrison has also confirmed if some states meet those targets ahead of others, well, their residents might get certain freedoms ahead of others, such as international travel. So if New South Wales, for example, hits a vaccination rate of 80%, its vaccinated residents could head overseas, even if they can't cross state borders. Charles?
Paris before Perth seems unbelievable, Fiona. Thank you. There's a grim outlook for Sydneysiders this morning as authorities warn the worst is yet to come, with infections expected to peak in the next fortnight. Today, Sydney reporter Sarah Stewart joins us from Liverpool Hospital in Western Sydney. Sarah, COVID medical care is going to look a lot different in the coming months.
It certainly is, Charles. Now, the Premier has told us the peak number of people getting COVID is going to happen over the next 2 weeks, so mid-September to late September. Then in October, we're going to see the highest number of people in hospital. And all of that means the way that our response happens is going to have to change. They've been working on this plan for the past 18 months and they're getting ready to introduce it. They say the modelling will be released next week, and that modelling is going to include changes. For example, they're looking at accelerating getting more graduate paramedics into the workforce. They're looking at cancelling annual leave for paramedics. They're looking at using firefighters on the front line as well. Obviously, they don't have the medical training as paramedics, but they may be able to assist with driving. They might be able to do decontamination, set up tents. We know the Rural Fire Service is also helping in regional New South Wales. They could also help in the city. It also means that if you go to hospital, you may not be taken to your closest hospital anymore. They're going to be looking at sharing the load between hospitals. We know over 1,400 cases yesterday, so if we are looking at a peak in around 2 weeks' time, there's some pretty scary numbers there, Charles.
Certainly, Sarah, thank you. After days of public anger, Queensland Premier Anastasia Palaszczuk has apologised for locking out her citizens while providing exemptions to NRL families and cricket stars.
And I apologise. It was not the right thing to do when we had the pause. It shouldn't have happened. Unfortunately, it did happen. It was not the right look.
The Premier has confirmed from Monday 680 rooms will be available for hotel quarantine after a two-week travel ban relieved pressure on the system. Roll up for a vaccine or get locked out. That's the warning from Victorian Premier Daniel Andrews. Under the plan, unvaccinated residents will not be allowed to return to sporting events, pubs and restaurants with their vaccinated counterparts once the state reaches its 80% vaccination goal. A new vaccine passport trial is right now in the works. It comes after the state recorded 208 new cases, including 112 mystery cases. It will be even more difficult for truck drivers from COVID-infected states to enter WA from next week. The new requirements are a negative COVID test in the 72 hours prior to departure, proof of at least one vaccination dose, use of the new G2G Now app, and COVID tests on day 2 and day 12. Australians are saving up their cash, with money in the bank expected to hit $200 billion this year. $25 billion was added in July alone as lockdowns in Sydney and Melbourne kept people indoors and spending less. The government hopes once lockdown ends, people will splurge their savings, boosting the economy. New South Wales police are searching a rural property in the Hunter region this morning for a missing three-year-old. The boy, named AJ, was last seen on the property in Putty, which is south of Singleton, at midday yesterday. He lives with autism but has not been known to wander before. Police are not treating it as suspicious at this stage. Overseas now, New Zealand police have shot and killed the violent extremist who was behind a mass stabbing attack at a supermarket in Auckland. TVNZ reporter Logan Church filed this report.
Six people remain in hospital, three in a critical condition following the devastating knife attack here at the Lynn Mall Countdown. You'll be able to see behind me police officers continue to block the car parks here. Meanwhile, more details are emerging about the man, Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern confirming he is a Sri Lankan national who arrived in New Zealand in 2011. He's been tracked by police since 2016 due to what's been called his violent ideology inspired by ISIS. Now, a surveillance team were able to get to the man within 60 seconds of the attack taking place yesterday, shooting him dead. Exactly why he was under police surveillance is subject to court suppression orders, which the Crown have asked to be lifted. We're expecting more details on that today. Meanwhile, the country has come together to support the victims of this attack, communities condemning the actions of this lone wolf. But as I said, we're expecting more details to emerge today as to exactly what happened at the mall behind me.
US President Joe Biden has agreed to make public a collection of classified documents regarding the government's response to the September 11 terrorist attacks. US correspondent Amelia Adams joins us from Los Angeles. Amelia, it comes just days ahead of the 20th anniversary of the attacks.
It does, Charles. 20 years, can you believe it? And Joe Biden's been under a lot of pressure over this because for survivors and for family members of victims of those 9/11 attacks, they have long suspected, many of them, that the FBI lied about or even destroyed evidence linking Saudi Arabia to the 9/11 hijackers. Now, this morning, Joe Biden coming good on a campaign promise, ordering his Department of Justice to declassify documents relating to the FBI's investigation and the Attorney General to release those documents over the next 6 months. Joe Biden said in a statement that the American people deserve to have a fuller picture of what their government knows about the attacks. There is a specific set of documents that are to be released by next week's 20th anniversary attacks, 20th anniversary of the attacks, I should say. And as I said, the president really has been under pressure. Only last month, about 2,000 Americans, some 9/11 survivors, family members of victims, first responders as well, they actually wrote to Joe Biden and told him not to bother showing up to any of the anniversary commemorative events unless he had declassified these documents. So today's move potentially sparing the president some embarrassment or snubs from those people at next week's memorial events. Charles.
Yeah, hopefully brings some closure to the families as well, Amelia. Thank you.